tremendous range that range from the southeastern United States all the way up to southern Canada. These are huge trees. These are massive trees that could outcompete nearly every other species in the forest. Almost every one out of every four trees in Appalachian forest is an American chestnut. They numbered over 4 billion in decline. They were even compared to redwoods and called the redwoods of the East simply because of their massive size. Because of their quick growth and really strong, straight grain timber, they were also cultivated widely as timber trees, and they even thrived in clear cuttings. They've also been cultivated for hundreds of years as producers of nuts. The nut of the American chestnut is extremely sweet and would used to provide food for people and wildlife. They were the quintessential chestnuts roasting over an open fire. But in 1905, a shipment of Japanese chestnuts arrived in New York, and it carried with it a fungus that causes chestnut blight. Chestnut blight was first observed in the Bronx Zoo, and from there it spread extremely quickly to the rest of the United States. In China and Japan, where the blight is originally from, it's a minor annoyance. The trees have evolved with it, they rarely notice. But obviously, in the United States, there's been no exposure whatsoever, and it is devastating. Within 50 years, nearly every single one of those 4 billion trees that once thrived in forests was infected and dying. The fungus Chrysanthemum parasitica infects trees by colonizing wounds that exist already in the bark. So anywhere where the bark is broken or torn, the fungus can enter. From the point of entry, the mycelium will spread outwards in a characteristic hyphal fan, and it will eventually girdle the tree and cut off its vascular system. The fungus kills everything above the point of infection. But because it always infects above the root collar, which is where the trunk splits into multiple branches, the stump continues to survive as a sort of living stump, which will put out shoots from dormant embryos in the root collar. However, these small shoots will also be quickly infected and killed back, which is how you get that little trunk there with sprouting branches. We don't have to understand this entire cycle. The gist is that ascomycetes, or sac fungi, are the largest phyla fungi. Chestnut blight is an ascomycete. They produce their sexual spores in a sac, or an ascus. Like almost all fungi, they have two methods of reproduction: asexual reproduction with conidium and sexual reproduction with ascus spores. That cycle is obviously much more complicated. Here are some examples of spore-bearing structures as they appear in Chrysanthemum parasitica. On the left, that's a Pycnidia. It's lined internally with conidia. These will eventually be splash dispersed, and they'll just be carried away by water or animals that walk through it. Anything that touches the spores will carry the fungus. On the right, on top, you can see those are parathecia. These contain the sexual ascus spores, which will eventually be ejected through the osteolar necks, which are both. The parathecia themselves are contained within a stroma. The stroma itself is what will eventually erupt through the bark of the tree and release the parathecia. Obviously, people have been trying to cure and treat chestnut blight in a number of ways. For a really long time now, they've been trying to breed American chestnuts with Chinese and Japanese chestnuts to try and obtain an American chestnut that is resistant to blight. More recently, they've been trying to genetically engineer an American chestnut, which is resistant. They've also tried applying fungicides. They've tried soil compresses on individual fingers. Nothing really has worked, which is too bad. But my primary focus was hypovirulence. Hypovirulence is a phenomenon in which a mycovirus or a fungal virus will attack the fungus, weakening it and significantly damaging its reproductive capability. It doesn't kill the fungus, but it gives the cold. It weakens it enough that the tree has an opportunity to build up callus tissue that will wall the fungus out. As you can imagine, it has enjoyed immense interest because of its potential as a biological control of chestnut blight. Hypovirulence originated in Europe, where it's still been most effective for a number of reasons. When it seemed that European chestnuts, the sweet chestnut, would reach the same fate as American chestnut, people began desperately looking for something that would exist to try and wall off this fungus. And actually, in northern Italy, near Genoa, people started discovering chestnuts which had cankers that were shallow rather than sunken. The fungus infecting them was white, it wasn't bright orange like it usually is. It had significantly reduced growth and sporulation. And more importantly, because of its extremely stunted growth, the tree had an opportunity to build up callus tissue and these huge calluses on the trunk. It didn't look pretty, but it kept the fungus away. It was found relatively early on when an uninfected, normal type sample of fungus was inoculated with this weakened hypovirulent fungus. Samples of mycelium from the normal type seemed to have been converted into the hypovirulent type. It was also confirmed that double-stranded RNA was associated with hypovirulent fungi, but not with normal. Mycoviruses which weaken their host fungi lack an extracellular phase. They can be transmitted either horizontally between fungi or through asexual spores, because the fungus eliminates them in their sexual acid spores. The dsRNA, which is a causal element of the hypovirulence phenomenon, isn't associated with any capsid. It's enclosed within pleomorphic lipid vesicles, which are actually derived from the host fungus's Golgi network. Anyway, how does this piece of unencapsidated dsRNA cause the severe symptoms? The genome of CHV1, which is the model and best studied strain of hypovirus, has been fully sequenced. This is the strain that originally occurred in Northern Europe, if it's the original. The coding region of CHV is split into two different open reading frames, which code for various proteins. The best known one is called P29. It's a protease in ORFA. It's really responsible for a bit of everything, especially the symptoms that we can actually see with our own eyes. For example, P29 has a direct role in downregulating chlamydiation, which is the most simple and primary method of fungal reproduction. It decreases the pigmentation that gives fungal infection its characteristic bright orange color. It even downregulates lactase activity. Lactase is an oxidase that breaks down lignin, which is a component of the chestnut cell wall. It enhances dsRNA accumulation, and it's the only viral element that's needed for integration into the Golgi network vesicles the virus needs for replication and even maybe transportation. What's interesting is that you don't even need its proteolytic activity to do all this. It doesn't have to be protease. All it has to do is be released from the polyprotein within ORFA. It's less clear what the other proteins and domains do. P40 is also included within ORFA. It's very conserved and basic. It probably also has some kind of indirect role in suppressing chlamydiation and pigmentation, but it primarily controls dsRNA accumulation. However, if you remove P40 from the virus and you just knock it out of its genome, the virus continues to be viable. dsRNA accumulation is important to us because it gives us clues, it influences other symptoms of hypovirulence, which are more noticeable to us, they're more overt, like the ones I mentioned when I was talking about ORFB we know less about. It's not involved in reduced virulence, and we're really not sure what it does, despite the fact that it comprises over two-thirds of the coding region of CHV. A couple studies have suggested possible roles for it. It might be involved in initiating gene expression, but because its role is so short and so brief, it's been termed hit and run, we really don't know why this is important. Probably it's more likely that ORFB is involved in changing the morphology of the fungus colony. We've noticed that fungi which are involved in hypovirulence usually grow normally. Their colonies are strangely shaped. And it's likely that ORFB has some kind of role in this. As you can expect, CHV affects a lot of host genes and processes that make this happen. It might be impressive to note that one study actually identified over 296 ACR products downregulated and 126 products upregulated by virus infection. That's a lot of changes, and they've been somewhat well studied, but a lot of them are still unknown. Anyways, there are more viruses, there are even mitochondrial viruses, there are a whole bunch, but we really don't know much about them, and in general, they're less pervasive and less effective. But the implications of the work that has been done on the CHV genome are pretty interesting, because if we can map viral domains and link them to changes in phenotype, we'd be able to modify or engineer a virus that strongly suppresses the pathogenic capabilities of the host fungus. But we could also engineer it so that it doesn't have severely reduced health and severely reduced chlamydiation. Because keep in mind, we need the fungus to sporulate. We need it to send out asexual spores in order to transmit the hypovirus. I don't really know how much of this work has been done. It's been brought up in a number of papers, but regardless, it has a lot of potential for hypervirulence as a biological control. It should sound like this is a great solution for reducing fungus viability and giving chestnuts a chance of fighting back. But there are a number of ways in which it's restricted. One of the best studied ones is vegetative incompatibility. It's a system that occurs in the fungus during hyphal anastomosis. Fungi grow vegetatively by branching out with hyphae, which are their filaments. When two hyphae of the same fungus connect, or anastomos, they can either recognize each other as a genetically individual, identical individual, so one function is a self-recognition system. But it can also form the basis of fungal sex. If two hyphae from genetically distinct individuals connect, they'll either form a bearish line at the of dead cells at the point of contact if they're vegetatively incompatible, or they'll form a viable heterocaryon at the point of contact if they are compatible. However, a heterocaryon that results from a vegetatively incompatible pair will grow really abnormally or grow really slowly, and it'll eventually undergo a programmed cell death. Anyways, why do we care? Think about the implications of putting a strong restriction on horizontal transfer. You protect against the transfer of deleterious genetic elements like plasmid, dysfunctional mitochondria, even microviruses. So now you have a system in place that prevents viruses from freely moving from one fungus to another. It's not a perfect system, it's leaky. So there will be some transmission that occurs between different vegetative incompatibility genotypes. It's vegetative incompatibility, which is, among other things, that provides some interesting clues to why hypodermins has generally been more effective in Europe than it has been in North America. In Europe, you'll see chestnuts surviving in coppices and orchards, which doesn't occur anymore in the United States. To be vegetatively compatible with another fungus, you generally have to be homoallelic at all six of the BC loci. So every combination of these genes is a different BC type. It turns out that there is a vastly greater number of these BC types in North America than there is in Italy or Switzerland in Europe. Even though you'd expect that with a leaky barrier, eventually viruses would be able to make it in all these groups. But there are studies which have calculated a model threshold of BC type diversity. If BC type diversity was over this threshold, then expected transmission would be low enough that viruses would not be able to evade. This is probably what's happening in the United States, as we can see. But we can't take this study as gospel because it had to estimate spatial restriction of virus transmission between fungi, and it's actually really hard to quantify that. Especially because you can disrupt specific alleles at specific vegetative incompatibility loci, this is a fantastically interesting study, system to study. For example, as you can see up here, these two strains, U21 and DK80, are naturally vegetatively incompatible. You can see the bearish line, that's dead cells, they will not form a viable heterocaryon. And if you simultaneously disrupt VIC6 in both strains, they're still vegetatively incompatible, nothing happens. But if you simultaneously disrupt it in both, you'll find that they become compatible and they will actually form a stable and growing heterocaryon. But we have to keep in mind, again, this is one of several factors, many of which are poorly quantified, which influence success for virus transmission. And a lot of studies that have been done on vegetative incompatibility have been done on glass plates in the lab. They haven't really been done in the field where it's most pertinent. So we've barely scratched the surface of this complex interaction of systems which complicates the problem of chestnut blight. We've covered phytopathology, fungal virology, and even touched on population genetics in the context of BC type diversity and C. parasitic colonies. We have to keep in mind that even though chestnut blight is terribly serious, it's only one of many small problems. You won't see any of these trees around today because these are American elms. These used to be really common in parks and streets, partly because of this beautiful arching effect can create. But in the early 1900s, a fungus causing Dutch elm disease was imported on European timber, much like chestnut blight. And now elms are largely killed off, except for where they survive in some very specific places. Chestnut blight doesn't kill the entire tree, remember, stump still survives. It does cripple the tree. However, I believe that Dutch elm disease does kill the entire tree. A lot of these beautiful forests in the Great Smoky Mountains are remainders of these even larger, sprawling forests that have survived from the last ice age. But they'll never be the same again because they've been affected by that insect, that balsam leaved algae that targets balsam firs and Fraser firs. In some places, Fraser fir mortality is nearly 99%, so a lot of these forests won't be coming back. They'll never be the same as they were before. And this is just a tiny part of it. The list goes on and on. You're all conscious of this. You know what a problem invasive species are. And the thing is, for most of these plant diseases or tree diseases, there is no effective treatment. Chestnut blight research has been going on for nearly a century now. These chestnut blight was first observed in 1905. Because these aren't well-publicized diseases that directly affect humans, there's not much fun lot of really valuable and interesting scientific knowledge from this problem. And I think it makes us much better equipped for the future in whatever similar problems appears to us. I'll end by quoting Sandra Nekosakis. She's actually a really inspired woman. She's been working in chestnut blight and other tree diseases since at least the 70s or 80s. She's been publishing for nearly half a decade at this point. She was quoted once as saying that everyone who works in chestnut is